Today we are going to talk about fractures of shaft of femur. Now we don't call them a fracture shaft of femur, we call them as diaphyseal fractures of femur. For sake of planning our treatment, generally diaphyseal fractures are divided into three categories. One is proximal, one third diaphyseal fractures. This is a better nomenclature to call them as diaphyseal fractures rather than what we used to call them as fracture shaft of femur. Look at this, this is the head, neck. So this is a normal femur. So this is the head of the femur. This is the subcapital region, neck region, trochanteric region. Then we have come to this is the diaphyseal region. And these two things are proximal and distal. Both sides you have got joint here, another joint here like this with tibia. So now we are going to talk about fractures which are below this region and again up to these regions. This is, as I already mentioned, a fracture that occurs here is upper one third, a fracture which occurs in the middle one third fracture, and which occurs near lower end like this, we call them as lower one third fractures. This is because each region or the part of the shaft has got its own muscular attachments or origins. So depending upon the muscles that are attached there, these fragments get rotated or they go into either varus or valgus. Or sometimes because of all these reasons, and especially lower one third fracture, they get flexed because the gastrocnemius heads are attached here, and because of that it may get flexed. So these are all different things. Because of the muscle attachment, you have got to classify them, because unless you know the basic anatomy of these fractures, we are not going to be successful. So unless we know the basic anatomy, in addition to regular attachment and blood supply and all that, it's not required at the undergraduate level. We're not going into those details. But basically, because of the attachment of the muscles, the fragments get displaced in different directions. That's why for planning our treatment, the fracture of the femur, especially diaphyseal region, that is, these two regions are not the proximal region and distal region. Again, technical terms we can call them as epiphyseal, metaphyseal, diaphyseal. So once the full grown adult bone is there, we better call them as proximal, and this is the shaft, otherwise diaphyseal region, this is the end of the bone. Having known that, then you have to know the nature of violence of these fractures. How do these fractures occur? These fractures mostly occur because of extreme violence, like motor vehicle accidents or fall from a height, or sometimes rarely direct assault with very heavy weapons. And of course, in osteoporotic bones in elderly people, much violence may not be required, just a rotation strain by just somebody falls, slips immediately, because the osteoporosis, the fracture, the entire femur gets twisted and rotated, that produces a big huge fracture. And if there is a direct injury, there will be more than one fragment. So sometimes the fracture may be, for example, take the fracture is like this here, and this another fragment, there will be multiple fragments like this, and again from here there is a continuation. So it depends upon the violence, how violent it is, whether it's a very violent accident or violent injury or a hefty personality, by his own weight there may be a spiral fracture like this. And sometimes what happens, in addition to that, what is known as fracture is there, then there is a fragment here, and this fragment is known as butterfly fragment. There is a separate fragment like this. Here, first we'll have to fix this fragment into position, then only we get a continuation. So it all depends upon number of fragment, the line of fracture and the nature of the bone. We'll have to plan the treatment later. So to start with, in the nature of violence, the commonest nature of violence is motor vehicle or any accident due to traveling. That's number one. Number two is fall from a height, motor vehicle accident, MVA, fall from height. Then mechanical injuries, and then simple accidental falls. So as an example, I'll tell you, recently about 6 months back, one of my professor's wife has been bedridden. She had a sudden pain in the knee joint. I suspected of accidental fall, even though there is no fall. She just had, while rotating in the bed, suddenly she had sharp pain, and the pain, there was persistent pain. Every time he was calling me, every time he was asking for x-rays to rule out any pathological fracture. There was, because if the bone is osteoporotic, simple small accidental fall or just rotation in the bed itself can cause these fractures. Because they are more or less, we call them pathological fractures because of the previous osteoporosis of the bone. So why I am telling you is, finally, after one and a half months, when I was away one day, the pain became so excruciating, he took the patient to another hospital where they had made a diagnosis of fracture of the distal and the femur. Of course, they did internal fixation. She is now normal. So that's why sometimes don't depend upon the type of violence itself. Most probably in normal bones, violence is needed for having a fracture of the femur. But still, in elderly people, there may not be any severe violence. Now, what happens to these people? How do they present to us? That is, presenting symptoms, history of fall or injury, as I have mentioned earlier. They come with pain, deformity, very much apparent. This is pain, of course, deformity. Then tenderness, abnormal mobility. See, as you know, any fracture produces hematoma. This produces pain. And then the fracture, it is there. Suppose there is a fracture here, and the bones get displaced like this. So because of this, patient will have a deformity, and if you touch there, they will wince with severe pain. That is the tenderness. And then if you try to touch the knee, normally the movement should occur at the joint. In this case, in femur, the mobility should take place either at the hip joint or at the knee joint. Here in the thigh, you see some abnormal mobility. As you see for the abnormal mobility, you will get the rubbing of the fragments against each other. That is known as crepitus. This is like, suppose two chalk pieces are there. This is not a chalk piece, of course. They rub against each other, they produce a noise. This is known as crepitus. That you can see nicely as crepitus. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now, because of these five things, there is loss of function. You will be wondering, what is this loss of function for a lower limb? A lower limb is meant for taking the weight and for mobility. Because of this, they will be immobile, that is, they can't stand, they can't walk. So this is the loss of function. In addition to this, in lower limb, you will have what is known as limb length inequality. You can see, when you look at the patient, one limb will look shorter than the like this, because there is a deformity here, there is a shortening, and then of course external rotation of the limb also will be there. It all depends upon how the fragments get rotated. Unlike in the trochanteric fracture here, the entire foot may be rotated inwards or outwards depending upon the attachment of the muscle to the particular fragment. So these are the things with which you have got to be careful. One should not try to elicit this crepitus, because crepitus means severe pain will be there, and just for the sake of, because the teacher has told you that one of the signs is crepitus. Don't try to elicit crepitus in a case of fracture femur. These other things, when you are incidentally abnormal, when you are trying to move the patient, sometimes you feel for it. This need not be specially elicited. So having seen all those things, another problem with these patients is their general condition also is to be assessed. They usually go in for what is known as neurogenic shock. So other things are features of neurogenic shock. And presenting some symptoms, just now we talked about the local symptoms, like all the things which I mentioned, they are all local. And then general symptoms. This is very, very important in fracture femur, because it is said that following a fracture femur can bleed nearly up to 500 to 750 ml into the soft tissues, even though the blood may not come out. So externally there may not be anything, but inside bleeding, internal bleeding, they say it could be even up to 2 liters depending upon the number of fragments and the nature of volume. So what happens because of that, two things can happen. One is pain may produce A, neurogenic shock, B, because of the excess bleeding, and sometimes there may be associated injuries including injury to the visceral organs. So there may be a lot of bleeding, it may produce circulatory shock. So because of this, there will be rapid pulse, or as you call it, tachycardia, hypotension. BP will be something like about 90/60, or sometimes may not be able to even record the diastolic pressure. So these are all the other symptoms. If you come across a fracture femur, you just should not leave by looking at the fracture femur. Immediately have a quick assessment of general condition, whether the patient is in neurogenic shock or circulatory shock, then you will have to take adequate measures before you shift the patient to even x-rays. You treat this, control the neurogenic shock by giving some painkillers or sometimes IV sedation, and then circulatory shock if necessary, use IV fluids, and then sometimes the patients may require even blood transfusion. As I already mentioned, these people may have other fractures or sometimes injury to head, that is head injury, or sometimes visceral organ injuries also might be possible. Recently I came across a case, of course everybody will be seeing lot of cases like this. Recent case, one of my relatives, she met with an accident. She had a spleen rupture, fracture femur, fracture humerus, and injury to the radial nerve. On the side of the fracture femur, hardly a year ago, we did a total knee replacement. Luckily, the fracture was proximal to the processes, so there was not much of a problem. What I am trying to emphasize is that the fracture femur people may have associated injuries which may result in shock, either neurogenic or vascular or circulatory. Now what will you do for these people? Then you confirm the diagnosis by X-ray. X-ray of the femur, AP and lateral. X-ray of femur, AP and lateral. Of course, before this, you got to give the patient analgesia or sometimes even sedation, IV fluids. So send the patient for X-ray after giving analgesia, sedation, and have a IV fluid running, because patient might go into again severe shock, there may collapse. So keep an open thing and keep IV line going. That's what is known as lifeline will be, should be there. Intracath is kept, bigger one, the 218 gauge. Best is to have some 18 or 16 gauge intracath for fluids to keep up running, because once the patient goes into circulatory shock, the veins collapse and very difficult sometimes even to get a vein after the patient goes into sudden shock. So that's why better immediately start IV fluids and then keep a line patent, so that if necessary, when blood transfusion is required, we can immediately push through the blood transfusion also. So keep taking all these precautions, then you send the patient for X-ray. And as usual, what is that you have got to see in the X-rays? The things that you have got to watch for in the X-rays is, number one, fracture line. This may be transverse, oblique, there will be multiple fragments. Then quality of the bone. So it may be transverse fracture and oblique fracture. multiple fragments and quality of the bone. And another important thing, any of these fractures, especially if they are in the upper one third or in the lower one third, especially lower one third fractures, you take it like this. This fracture line sometimes looks simple. You may think the fracture is only after that. From here, there is a small line going into the condyle, or sometimes a small line going into the end of the bone involving the joint. So you have got to be very careful, especially in the lower one third and proximal one third, whether there is any fracture line going into the joint. If this is there, our mode of approach is going to be different. Whereas if there is a fracture only up to here, the approach is going to be something else. So that's why quality of the bone is important, transverse fracture, oblique fracture, multiple fragment, and involvement of the joint. All these things you have got to see in the x-rays. And as I always mention, take x-ray of the chest also, and ECG, if nearby it is available, take x-ray of chest and ECG, electrocardiogram, EKG some people call it. And we generally in India we call it as ECG. Some people may call it as EKG. The main thing is to know the function of the heart, and if needed, if the patient is elderly and giving history of hypertension, diabetes, and then previous CABG, all those things, bypass surgery and all those things, you have got to ask for 2D echo. So these are the, anyhow, all these things can be done near the X-ray department, all these things are over. And incidentally, you take the blood for all the parameters that are needed for knowing the safety of the patient at the time of anesthesia. So along with them, what is known as, we call it as surgical profile nowadays. That surgical profile includes the assessments of diabetes, kidney function, liver function, blood group, clotting time, bleeding time, all things are covered in that surgical profile blood test. We call them in general surgical profile. This includes grouping, you know, HB, that is simple, a complete blood picture, clotting time, bleeding time, blood urea, and then serum creatinine, then the, especially in the case of persons whom we are going to operate, it will become mandatory to eliminate the possibilities of HIV, HB. All these things, if necessary, other blood or diabetes also, you have got to do all these things. So the purpose is, as you know, unless you do all these things, you can't get a clearance. Of course, if you want, you do get clearance in spite of being HIV and all that. The entire team has to take special precautions. That's why you're very careful about the serology also in all these cases. Then only you plan your treatment. Now we talk about the management of these fractures of the femur. Fracture management, two, general comorbid condition, and then other injuries. So when you talk about fracture management of shaft of femur, we just discussed, but what are the other possibilities? People will usually come with hypertension, diabetic, previous cardiovascular history, bypass and all those things. These people we cannot straight away. And another important thing, most of the people, these people will be on treatment, aspirin. They will be in aspirin either 75 milligrams or sometimes 150 milligrams. Or they will be either taking aspirin or other blood thinners or other things like statins. You don't remember these two things, aspirin and statins, this may be sometimes 75 or 150. Some people may have a combination of both, 1 and 2. Why I am mentioning this, there are certain instances where people have forgotten about these things and they ended up in disaster. The bleeding will be so high that you may lose the patient on the table itself or postoperative because of the, as you know, these things are blood thinners. Because of continuous leakage of blood, there will not be clotting mechanisms affected. So all these things are there. They themselves may produce sometimes fatal bleeding and may lose the patient. then there's no point in, no, you are already having these things, because of that she did not survive. If you are there, treatment of fracture management, or the fracture management should not be given top priority, and at the risk of these things you should never operate. You can always wait for 3 days or 5 days, nothing would happen, stabilize the patient, give temporary traction or something, and then stop these things at least for 3 to 5 days. If the patient is only on aspirin 75 milligrams, we can do the surgery after 3 days, and if there's a combination, sometimes we will have to wait for 5 days. So, because once again I repeat, fracture management of femur is not an emergency unless a multiple fracture, somehow or other you want to do something. But still, when these things are there, take all the necessary precautions, then only you go for surgery. Similarly, if the diabetes is not under control, give time. And peculiarly, or of course nothing peculiar about it, lot of patients might be on oral anti-diabetic medicines. If they are in oral diabetic anti-diabetic medicine, you have got to switch on the patient to insulin. So sometimes it may take 24 to 48 hours to stabilize the diabetes. Or hypertension, for example, patient may have very high blood pressure following the injury, and after recover from initial shock, the blood, because of the pain, the hypertension may be very high, as much as sometimes 200 to 100, like that. So these people should be stabilized first from the comorbid conditions, then you have got to go for that. And similarly, other injuries, for example, these people have got injuries from intra-abdominal injuries like spleen rupture, liver rupture, first take care of them. Similarly, head injury, if it requires emergency treatment for head injury, attend to them, then we can make it. Always believe, and it should be always, that life is first, then the limb. A fracture can easily be neglected for a few days, nothing will happen, because once the fracture is there, prior with other comorbid conditions, other injuries which are more serious in nature, you can always give some first aid to these fractures and then attend to them first and then come back to other things. So these are the others, so you have got to plan the things. Suppose the patient is in shock, give adequate blood fluids, all those things, stabilize, and then take the patient. Now again you go back to the management per se. Here one is conservative, operative. Now 99.9% of the patients are better off with surgery. Only a very minority, about say less than 1%, will have to manage conservatively. That is because the poor general condition, patient is not for surgery, some people are afraid of surgery, they will not agree for surgery, there's so many other alternatives. These people only should be allowed to go in for conservative management. Now with the latest anesthesia techniques, post all better post-op management and intensive care unit, and then the new development of better implants which are very, very suitable for each typical type of fracture. We got so many options of implants. With all these things being available, there's no point in going in for conservative treatment. If at all you require conservative treatment, the patient is not willing for surgery, he can't afford for surgery, if we insist, maximum that we could do is put them on Steenman's pin. Steenman's pin traction on what is known as Bowler. This is an outdated thing, but still, under circumstances, certain circumstances, we'll still going for this Steenman's pin traction on Bowler bronze splint. Because normally, if you say this, the modern orthopedic surgeon will laugh, but this is what we were doing till about 3-4 decades ago in India. Perhaps about 50 years ago in some of the advanced countries as well. Another type of conservative treatment is much worse, which involves a lot of risks of pressure sore, so many other things and all that, is still probably for the children, you can still use what is known as plaster Paris hip spica. So here, in plaster Paris hip spica, we apply plaster Paris from the level of the nipples. Because this is the lower limb, this is lower limb like this, then the body is there. The plaster Paris comes from here, from the level of limbs, it comes down, entire thing is included in plaster Paris, and it comes down up to the foot. entire thing is covered with plaster Paris, like this. We rarely use this, it's only a theoretical possibility I'm just giving you as for completion sake. Still sometimes we do this for young children above the age of 2 years, up to 4 to 5 years. People are afraid of doing surgeries because previously we were not having proper types of internal fixation for these children. So sometimes the children used to outgrow the implants, and we used to feel a lot of difficulty in taking out the implant. Now there are so many types of implants are available where without actually damaging the epiphysis as well as without causing any discrepancy due to growth, we can usually use those things and fix the fracture of the femur even in children. But in some cases we can still apply plaster of Paris, hip spica, and that is the conservative management. I told you already, most often we require operative treatment for fractures of the shaft of the femur. So what are the operative options? Operational options are, we call them as open reduction, internal fixation. In this category, one is intramedullary fixation, then extramedullary. In intramedullary fixation, we have got what is a Kunscher nail. It used to be the very common treatment till about 20-25 years ago. Before the availability of SIAM everywhere, everybody used to do this Kunscher nail. This is one type. Another type is locking nail, interlocking nail. So this is the standard procedure now, interlocking nail. This is Kunscher nail. Here also, now the advantage of interlocking nail, nowadays we not have to actually do any open reduction. Without open reduction, with the help of SIAM, we can do the nail from proximal to this. Whereas here, in Kunscher nail, you have got to open, then retrograde, that is the femur. Suppose there's a fracture here, this is the upper end. You first open this here and pass the guide wire like this, then introduce the nail and put it back. This is what is known as retrograde. Push the nail out first, like this. Then bring it here, reduce the fracture, then drive it down. Now this is retrograde, that is from here we go to the proximal area, then come back up to that and then reduce and put it back. This used to be a lot of problems used to be there, because sometimes it's very difficult to get a proper position, and more than the proper position, because of lack of SIAM, sometimes we used to have bigger nail, longer nail, or the diameter may be different, because if the diameter is loose, there's a rotation. Suppose this is the fracture subshaft. Now you can see this nail is, suppose if I put a intramedial nail, this is size is correct. Instead of that, if I use a small thing, smaller nail, whose diameter is less, they used to rotate like this. So there never used to be stability at the fracture site, or sometimes because of lack of SIAM, we don't know how far down we used to go, and similarly upward also. So sometimes we used to make certain mistake, even though lot of guide wires are there which we can easily know the correct length and all that. Sometimes in spite of all those things, we used to have some problems, and most common thing we used to have was the rotation of the nail inside the femur, and that's why we gradually stopped this Kunscher nail and started using this interlocking nail. What is the advantage of this Kunscher's nail? Now take this as femur. If you take this as femur, fractures here, and then we can continue. So this is the proximal part of the fragment, this is the distal part of the fragment. The advantage of this is the interlocking nail will be inside, and what we do is we allow with what is known as jig. The jig will be placed in such a nice way, it will come through the outer cortex of the femur, through the nail and through this, and it goes into neck of the femur. So this goes into this femur nicely and gets locked, and there will be another transverse screw. This will be fixed into the neck of the femur, and the transverse screw will be fixed like this, through the femur, through the rod, through this. So here the purpose is, you will not allow the rod to move inside. And simply as you come down here, you can reverse and keep under two screws here, like this. It will go through the femur, through the rod, and this one again, another one also can be used. So here the purpose is to see that this does not move inside, like this. So this is why, because we lock the nail inside, it is known as interlocking nail. Because more technical details are not necessary, all the length also can be measured properly, and then we fix the things. But for this we have got special jigs, even distally also jigs are available, but now with all experience we can do with a free hand by just using a C-arm guide. This is the most advanced and the recent thing we are doing. Again, in this intramedullary, there are various types of nails are available which are not necessary for a normal undergraduate student of orthopedics. But at least some of these things are fundamental, because I hear a lot of my colleagues, they don't know the difference between intramedullary and extramedullary, even a screw and a plate. The people, as well as even people who have gone surgery done outside the country also, they come back and tell us, sir, a rod has been put and I want the rod to be removed, without knowing whether it's a rod or a plate or a screw. So rod has become a common word for fixation of these fragments. So please remember, at least at the basic graduate level, you must know that different types of fixations are there for different types of fractures of the diaphyseal fractures of the femur. Now we talk about extramedullary fixation. It's a fracture here. Okay, in extramedullary fixation, or the fractures, I'll talk about first a simple fracture without going into these complicated spiral fractures or oblique fractures. Here, we openly reduce the fractures, put them in position. On top of it, we put a plate like this. And these plates have got sliding holes. As we put the sliding holes, here there's a screw here, a screw here, a screw here. Idea is, there must be at least 6 screws, that is 3 above the fracture site, 3 below the fracture site. These screws should come like this. And these fracture screws just must come beyond the opposite cortex. This is known as near cortex, this is the far cortex. Important thing, the screw length should be, it should just come out of the farther cortex, this, like this. At least 3 should be there above and 3 should be there below the fracture length. This is the most fundamental thing in fixing the plate, that is the extramedullary fixation. Here, because we are not putting inside anything through the medulla, we call it as extramedullary. This is the simplest type of plates, but the commonly used plate now is known as dynamic plate. Previously, the plate, if you look at the plate, maybe 4 holes, 6 holes, it used to be round. Once you fix that, these fragments which are fixed will not move. Now what? That's why, to produce compression at the fracture site, they made them into a semi-oval like this. All these things are made into semi-oval. The screw, when tightened, it slides from either side. This also it is slide towards this side. They are not round, but little bit of oval in shape. As you tighten up, the screw comes down. As it comes down, it brings both the fragments together. Suppose a little gap is there like that. When you tighten them up, they come together and this place is completely obliterated. But here in this, that cannot happen. Once you fix the fragments here, if by any chance a gap is there, it remains like this and it may not unite. So that's why people have started using dynamic compression plates. Now, in this, especially for osteoporotic bones, where you don't want to, suppose there are multiple fragments, you don't touch the fragments. For those fragments, suppose there's a fracture here and here, multiple fragments are there, even fractures up to this. What we do is, instead of opening these things, we put a plate, what is known as bridging plate. Put L-shaped and then push the plate upwards, subperiostally like this, without opening. In this there are different shapes like this, or you can have L plate or a plate which is fits into the condyle. Then we fix the lower part of the skull and then push it along the shaft of the femur without actually touching the fragments. Then we put the screws again. This is known as bridge plating. That is, we actually don't touch the fracture site. And this further advance is the locking plate. In locking plate, what happens, just like the one in intramedial nail, here the screws also may turn. But here, if you use this locking plate with locking screws, this plate, the screw will get locked inside the bone and it gives a click-like sound. That means the plate cannot move, nor the screw. It gives a click-like noise at the last torque. When you finally turn it and make it tight, it gets locked. The purpose is, especially in osteoporotic bones, what happens, the plate may go up and down or the screws may become loose and come out. But in locking compression plate, the plate gets locked onto the bone with the typical type of screw. So this is the latest thing we do for osteoporotic patients and where we don't want to actually touch the fracture light. So we just fix it here into the condyle and push the plate upwards far beyond the fracture site. At least above the fracture site, suppose this is the last fragment you come across, at least above there must be 3 or sometimes even 4 or 5. Here 2 or 3. So without proper locking here, it will be a failure. The most important thing about these multiple fragments, otherwise we can't fix the plate into these multiple fragments. So instead of touching them, use this bridge locking plate or a locking compression screw with plate. That is the advantage of these things. This is how we treat most of the fractures of the shaft, the diaphyseal fractures are treated in this way. But the latest and more advances in the metal also has come. Previously, we used to have only stainless steel type of material. Now more advances are there in the metallurgy also. We are now using what is known as titanium material. Titanium is material that is made of from titanium. The advantage of titanium, it's of a lighter than stainless steel. It is not less possibilities of corrosion or probably least possible corrosion. And then the important thing nowadays, a lot of patients go travel abroad and all that. And everywhere, not only while traveling, even inside each mall, each shop, each place, nowadays there's high security and people, when they go through that, you know, security area, it gives a bleep if there's a stainless steel plate. Whereas if you use a titanium plate, even though it's more expensive than a stainless steel plate, you will not get that sound also. And one more thing, if you have a stainless steel plate, subsequent MRIs are not possible. The MRI, when it alters the signals in MRIs, if you use a stainless steel plate. That's why more and more people nowadays we are using titanium material, titanium screws, titanium plates, titanium rods. Everything is now practically available in titanium for internal fixation. So we are using more and more titanium. First, light, two, not affected by rusting or corrosion or reaction to the body. Third, it will not interfere with MRI pictures taken subsequently. And fourth, it will not cause any alarm while passing through security check areas. Then what is the post-operative management? This is very, very important. Without knowing how to do, you just fix it up and ask the patient. Naturally, any patient whom you are going to operate will ask you several questions. Especially, they are worried about what to eat. What is the post-op management? First thing, anybody wants to know what is the food they have got to eat. They can practically eat anything, everything. And especially if the people are, because in India a lot of them are vegetarians, they are worried about pulses. Some of the pulses look yellowish. So they think if they take pulses, there may be infection. We tell them that initially we have given enough antibiotic cover and if need be, we'll provide for some more days. Usually we stop, you know, but a lot of people in India were worried and we give it for nearly a week, which is not really necessary. And second thing is when to start walking. That is the commonest thing. So anybody who has been having injury and his leg is broken, he would like to go back to normalcy and normal work immediately. But here, one thing you remember is, even though we are doing the fracture treatment, external splinting, plaster paris, or traction, whatever it is, the time taken for the fracture treatment is not less than 10 to 12 weeks. So especially if you are very, very sure about your locking mechanism, exact anatomical reduction, in every way you are satisfied, theoretically a good sound internal, rigid internal fixation, patient can take the weight. But in practice, better to be on the safer side rather than taking chance. So you make the patient stand with the help of walker. Walker can be used on the second day or the third day without any hesitation. Use a walker. They can stand with a walker on the second day itself, and then they can active mobilization of the knee joints, of joints. After 6 to 8 weeks, gradual weight bearing. 6 to 8 weeks, you start gradual weight bearing. If the patient is not having any pain, there is no swelling, there is no reaction, gradually you can increase. By about third or fourth month, patient can get rid of the walker. That's the usual plan. But once again, I repeat, the purpose of doing a good internal fixation is to make the patient ambulatory. But especially in India, we don't take a chance because our people's bones are not that strong, number one. Number two, they are a little reckless and they may take the things easy. So that's why we always make the patients take rest, avoid the weight bearing till at least 6 to 8 weeks from there, gradual weight bearing. Of course, before that, we take regular periodical x-rays. That's how we mobilize the patient. Normal transfer fractures, which are not comminuted, by third month or fourth month, they should be able to come back to their normals. Then finally, the complications. In this per operator, during operation, patient may go into shock. If the patient is not adequately and properly anesthetized, the patient may go in for shock. Number two, after that, for anesthesia complications, if any, anesthetic complications. Then, post-op, most dreaded thing is infection. This infection may lead to delayed union sometimes, non-union. Patient will have to undergo several operations later because of the infection. So you should never ever allow infection to settle down here, because the most important thing, post-operative infection is the most dreaded complication on that. And then fat embolism. Fourth or fifth day, usually people have this fat embolism. And then DVT, deep vein thrombosis, immediate post-operative. And late, once again, could be infection, delayed union, small union, and finally implant failure. Implant may break. All these things, I am talking about a straightforward diaphyseal fracture femur. If associated fractures are there, there may be so many other complications also. Thank you.